I'm 12 years old. I go in with fake working papers, and I tell them that it's illegal to have a sign that says boy wanted.
She's acted in Italian movies, modeled for an artist, answered phones for call girls, and been a speck on a wall of granite.
At last counting, I've had 64 jobs. Now, I'm not 236 years old, so obviously some of them are of unusually short duration.
If you think people are defined by what they do, she has something to tell us all.
Nobody is just a typist, just a dishwasher, just a cook, just a porter, just a prostitute. That everyone has a story.
American Playhouse presents Claudia Shear in Job Number 65, Blown Sideways Through Life. The presentation of American Playhouse is made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, by annual financial support from viewers like you, and by the National Endowment for the Arts.
It's time to go to work. It's 3 o'clock and I'm sitting on a bench putting on a pair of cop shoes. It's 10:30 in the morning and I'm pulling on thick janitor gloves and picking up a bucket. It's 4:15 in the morning and I'm trying to take a nap on Wall Street by balancing my head on the toilet paper roll. It's 5 o'clock and I sharpen my pencils, I sharpen my knife, I fasten on a phone headset, I totally undress. I put on lipstick, I tie a bow tie, I put on Mardi Gras beads, and then I carry up cases of beer, tubs of chicken, stacks of documents, flats of eggs, trays of lipstick, and I set up the computer, the desk, the room, the stock. Then I begin to chop the onions, read the documents, answer the phone, answer the phone, answer the phone. Good afternoon, Battle Fowler, Jaffin, and Kiel. Good morning, Shakespeare Festival. Buonasera, le madri.
Hi! We have five very pretty girls here. We have two brunettes, a redhead, and two very bestie blondes. It's 95 for the hour, 75 for the half hour. That includes French and straight coming twice in the hour, once in the half hour.
Wall Street Services, NYU Medical Center, patient information, what room, please? And they tell me, well, chill on the conversation. Don't stand over there. Be nice to the customers. Put your book away. No reading allowed, no personal calls. Get off the phone. Don't sit down. Oh, Claudia, here's a club in case they come to rob the restaurant late at night when I'm not here. Watch your mouth. No eating. Don't attack on the console without permission. Remember to always give your name. Never give your name. And they tell me there's been complaints about your attitude. You were heard whistling in the elevator, singing in the dining room. You talk too much. You laugh too loudly. You are insubordinate to a manager. You have to do what we tell you without arguing. You spend too much time on the phone. Maybe you should drink less coffee so you wouldn't go to the bathroom so much. It doesn't matter if you're good. The floor runs better when it's all men. You were warned about reading at the desk. There's no standing around. You have to look busy. The girls wear leotards because that is what our customers like. And my own personal favorite, I don't have to give you a reason. It's my restaurant. Listen, you got to be kidding. I told you 3 weeks ago that I needed Wednesday off. Why are you screaming at me? This isn't plasma for sick children. It's a real estate contract. I'd better. I'd better. Oh, you're really f***ing me now. What are you going to do, tell my mother? Personally, I wouldn't take a job which required me to monitor how frequently people went to the bathroom. Not only do I not know about pastry cream, Carlos, I don't give a shit about pastry cream. Now let's have a conversation about all things I know that you don't. How dare you scream at him like that, you homophobic bully? I'm sorry, but I can't truly value your opinion of me when your penis is probably this big. Listen, we're going to have to let you go. After this week, we won't need you. This is your last shift. There's going to be some changes in the schedule. You don't like it, it's my way or the highway. Get out and don't come back. You're fired. And each time I say, all right. All right. All right. And then sometimes, I say, fuck you. I read from a book. Most people seem to live in character. They have a beginning, a middle, and an end. They have a class, they have a place, they know what is becoming in them and what is due to them. But there's also another kind of life. One gets hit by some unusual transverse force. One is jerked out of one's stratum. and one lives crosswise for the rest of the time. That's me. Blown sideways through life. I'm from Brooklyn. That's where I'm from. Dancing the rumba with my mom to Green Eyes. Running from cop cars with the friends I carefully chose. Girls like Janine Morelli, who was mean and punched me like a boy. God, did I want in. In with girls like Kathy and Debbie and Ronnie. Skinny girls with fat asses who bit their nails and painted them anyway. We were tough. We hung out. Girls who didn't know about feeling up and tongue kissing. We broke bottles and made out in alleyways and hid our cigarettes in bushes so we could get them back the next day, crushing the leaves between our fingers to mask the smell of smoke. I was a prime target. God knows how they knew I was different. I smoked and cursed and fought. But the part of me that still believed in Narnia and cried for black beauty must have somehow given me away. A misfit in Flatbush. I wanted out so badly. I wanted to fit in so much. Out late at night in a public park, breaking windows, dry humping in doorways, crying as I staggered home, vomiting cheap wine into the gutter, sullen in my filthy uniform blouse, called before the principal again, waiting for my mother to arrive, flawlessly chic, bone thin, and smelling of Secret of Venus. Girls didn't get into trouble the way I did. I was defiant. I'd learned that by 8 years old, lying. Blank-faced and unflinching in family court after a year of bruises with my father's new wife. But inside my head, there was romance. And there was adventure. I'm running through the highlands with Alan Breck. I'm on a desert island, a magic mountain, a horse with wings. I wanted adventure. The cottage in the woods with the enchanted sword, the search for the grail. I'm suffering and striving in great feats of strength and ennobling tests of character. This is the plan for my life. And this is actually my life. At last counting, I've had 64 jobs. Now, I'm not 236 years old, so obviously some of them were of unusually short duration. The briefest being at a restaurant called Bar Louie. I got hired. I went in. I drank an iced coffee. A few phone calls. After about 10 minutes, the manager interrupted me. We have very specific policies regarding personal calls. So you got your coat, your keys, your token, your ticket, your passport, your cash card, and you hit the road, Jack, out the door, on a subway, a train, a plane, a bus, walking to an address, a corner, a park, a bar. Life can spin on a dime. You can stop for a donut and end up living in another country. Burkhoff's Hardware Store on Coney Island Avenue. I'm 12 years old. I go in with fake working papers, and I tell them that it's illegal to have a sign that says, boy wanted. I get the job. Cleaning toilets. But what I really did was moon around the stockroom waiting for Barney, the stock boy, to notice me. He was thick. He was hairy. He was stupid. He was 16. He had a shag haircut. And I loved him. To be so young that you want to be older. I'm 13 and a half. I get a job in an Italian fast food place in a mall. It's a full hour from my house. I'm anonymous. I'm able to create the entire mnemonically perfect scenario necessary to lie about my age. I hung out with girls in cars and froze my face so I wouldn't utter gasps of disbelief at the shocking bits of information so casually revealed to me. This was glamour. This was nights out in Manhattan in loud discos, doing the hustle with the required bored face that implied, I go out all the time. I'm not even thinking about this. I would keep some of the money back that I gave my mother and buy wonderfully trashy clothes like wrap halter dresses and red crepe pantsuits with a peplum. And these shoes. In the 1970s, these shoes cost $100. My mother freaked out. Up on these shoes, I was grown up. I was somewhere else. I was someone else. I couldn't believe that I was worthy to own these shoes. They were so cool.
Do you think this is a prop?
You're wrong. I ran for the bus in these shoes.
I once had a job as a nude model for a painter. Not just some guy, but a great painter. A grand, absolutely eccentric, obsessed painter. Bit of a genius, I think, with the occasional chilling gaze of the true monomaniac. He says things like, art should have a smell. A smell, a smell. Because then if it was bad, nobody would have it in their house. Huge, skylit studio with jazz on the radio, and the whole place filled with this empty, quiet light. It was the absolute safest place I've ever been. Which is strange, considering I was buck naked on a large table, had old bedspreads, the muscles in my back all tense and twisted, and being really conscious of being really naked. Feeling all breasts and skin and hair with someone, with a man staring at you that intently. It was great. You're actually part of the art as it's happening, like being a piano or a toe shoe, and to be beautiful. I love being beautiful. Well, I don't mean just pretty, like some girl at a table at Raoul's in a size 6 dress from Barney's, laughing with her wine glass as her eyes flicker to see who's watching. But beautiful. Beautiful like a woman in a painting.
I get a job at Helena Rubinstein in Bloomingdale's. I'm a makeup artist. I'm 15. During the glory days of pure excess, of entire menagerie set up on the main floor, phalanxes of dancing girls, bushels of rose petals, all for the first day of a new perfume. I would change out of my girl school uniform and transform into an overpainted sales girl. Behind the counter we stood, arrogant, aloof, in fashionable masks of concealer, base, foundation, blush, powder, eyeliner, brow pencil, contour shadow, shimmer highlighter, lip liner, gloss. Our bizarre and perfect faces turning slowly. Our Etruscan smiles as we murmured, everyone is using cream blush. Everyone. I was truly blasé. I mean, I knew girls who were in their 20s and were from France.
I'm freelancing for a ratings firm down on Wall Street, Standard & Poor's, looking up tiny numbers in huge blue books, trapped like a rat in a maze of nose-high partitions. I worked like 80 hours a week because I was saving to go study abroad. So one day I get on the elevator with one of these, you know, low-level guys in a bad tie, and he looks over and he goes, hey, I hear you're going to Italy.
Yeah, I said, yeah.
I said, I'm out of here in 3 more weeks. And he looks at me and he says, 30 more years. How much is a tax on $13? Do you serve from the left or the right? Do you type, do word for windows, take dictation, do French service, armed service, tray service? Do you own a tuxedo, have a beeper, drive a car, live in Manhattan? Will you work Sundays, midnights, every weekend, no weekends, just lunches, only dinners, on call when we need you? $5 from the left. Yes, 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 yeah, no, 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 yes, yes, yes. Yes, you see, you always have to say yes to get a job. Never have a personality, a light, a life, an opinion, and smile when you say yes. Oh, no, yes isn't good enough. I don't just have to say yes to some fool in a cheap suit, engorged with the majestic power to hire and fire at a steakhouse on 2nd Avenue. I have to smile at the turd, and if I don't, it means that I have a bad attitude. A bad attitude? You can't imagine my attitude, you steaming lump of excrement, you cretinous pig, you twisted bastard of whore.
Yes.
You, screw you, I'd like to smack you so hard your whole family would cry. Screw off and die in the street. Die under a bus.
Yes.
I'd like to kick you to death in front of your dog, you monster. How dare you let me? How dare you? I can't take it. I can't. Even if it's my fault, I can't. To smile and say yes makes me feel like my mouth is packed full of sand and shit. Grant, that moment when you get a job, great. Great. That moment of the first paycheck, but all too soon, there's that clench in your stomach as the dread punch-in, sign-in, be-on-the-floor time approaches. And as you walk to the first table, as you pick up the first document, as you punch the first button to take the first call, you think, oh, I'll never get through this. Until finally your shift is and it's time for the late-night ride in the taxi, counting your cash by the streetlights, and, sitting down after hours on your feet is as pure as drinking water, as satisfying as biting into an apple. You're too fired up to go to sleep, so you just sit at the kitchen table. It's really late. It's really quiet. You're tired. Don't want to go to bed, though. Going to bed means this was the day. This May 12th. This March 2nd. This September 23rd is over. You're tired. You made some money. But it didn't happen. Nothing happened. You got through it. And the whole day of your life is over. And all it is, time to go to bed. My tasks are too hard. There is no grail. There is no treasure. And the only talismans that protected me were the constancy of books and the comfort of food. Till I was really well read and over 200 pounds. The human sofa, I joked, because I wore a gray skirt made of upholstery fabric. I wore it every day. That year, the year of the skirt, was the year that Buster Keaton became my boyfriend. One night, I'd gone to a theater in Greenwich Village, and there I saw my first Keaton film. The first shot of his face opened something inside me. His face had the etched perfection of a classical statue and the liquid, compassionate eyes of a Perugino Madonna. His eyes and his baby films, even as an old man, were always the same. What other girls told their lovers, I told him in my heart. He was so beautiful, so graceful. There's a moment in the film The General where we see Buster as a young engineer driving his locomotive, and he leans forward and brushes off a tiny spot. That this huge machine is known to him down to the smallest speck of dust. His was not just passion, but the pride of having a great love of something and being really good at it, even if no one else understood. This I could understand. In his film Cops, at the end, there's a shot of an empty street, a deserted world, and then far off at the farthest point, a lone figure, Buster, running. The street behind him fills with cops, a fantastic number of cops, bearing down the swift but doomed fugitive. Here was my kindred spirit, who ran the way I ran in my dreams after I finished plodding through the day. I am going to study fencing with Mr. Barta. Advance, advance, advance. Retreat, retreat, retreat. Lunge. Putting aside the $23 I needed each week from limp piles of my tip money, when I complained to Mr. Barta about his chronic lateness, he said, please, Claudia, don't make a scenery. I run from work, my horrible proofreading cubicle, changing into my tights in the cold corporate toilet, as I run for the R train to skid onto the stinky woody floors of the Clark Center. The sound of the drums, the drummers nodding, nodding to the beat of the drums, the documents forgotten, the fluorescence sweating itself out of my body, as my teacher Charles Moore says, you gotta dance like this. Like you got a big jewel of your grandma's right here, and you want everybody to see. And if you hesitated and looked around, he'd say, don't look at your friends are wrong. Sneaking off the floor of my restaurant job, listen, can you cover my last two deuces for me? I gotta go to my French class. Je dois aller à l'école. running to my sanctuary at the Alliance Française, hunched over my exercise books with the ladies who lunch. Hier soir, je travaillais pour 18 heures. Last night, I worked for 18 hours. Oh, God, a room of people thinking, dancing, juggling, fencing. And if I have to go back to work, I'll go. But I'm not letting the world of money and bosses define my day. Job follows job in syncopation. Getting a job, quitting it. Getting a job, quitting it. Getting a job, quitting it. Getting a job, getting fired. Getting a job, getting fired. Getting a job, getting fired. From jobs that are a joke to jobs that aren't funny. Getting fired from jobs, I should have quit. As the time span of the job shortened, the quality of the job decreased. From the kind of job where you fill out an application form, right down to the kind of job where the guy pays you with cash, pulled from his pants pocket. I went through jobs like a hot knife through butter. I went through butter like a hot knife through butter. I was really stoned all the time. I was really fat all the time. So, it's another bummer summer because you're fat. No shorts for you because you're fat. It's the absolute nadir of the misfit. You're a misfit because nothing fits. You don't fit in. You're not fit. You're fat. Not the poetic cachet of alcohol. Not the whiff of danger from the drug of choice. You're just fat. And it's so un-American. It's so unattractive, unerotic, unfashionable, unaesthetic, undisciplined, unthinkable, uncool. I've been fat. Really fat. The kind that makes you invisible and makes you conspicuous. Standing at the kitchen window with my forehead pressed against the glass, looking down to the street and watching as a girl who's all dressed up on a Saturday night gets into a car and drives away. And you're crying. Because you're fat. So you're free-falling. You've slipped between the cracks. The center cannot hold. The rule book is lost. You're outside the pale. You've been fired once too often. The ecstasy of relief of the job left. The orgasm of the nasty retort spoken. No, I have a better idea. Why don't you kiss my ass? And then you're out on the street, and fresh air and freedom turn sour as the fear beneath begins to mutter. What am I going to do? What am I going to do? I have no money. I have no money. My chest is like a fist. Oh, God, I really did this time. And the panic grows, and you have to stop for a second at a pay. And pretend to make a call so you can catch your breath. You'll be all right. You'll be all right. You won't go under. That's the unthinkable, to go under, not just lose what you have. Poor isn't about not having. Poor is about fear. To lose all potential. To know slackly, loosely, mostly asleep on a dirty sheet that half covers a pitted foam pad, that this is what you are meant to be. So you meet a friend and you smoke a joint on a bench in a park, or you stand on a piece of a bookstore and you read in the aisles. Oh, it's so nice not to be working, and it's so horrible to be out of a job. Talking about it gives it a glow, though, you know? Failure reflects back as danger. The shudder of black leather, East Village, facial flesh pierced with rings. You feel proud. You feel cool. You can do this. You can live through this. It's the cocksure glance of the handcuffed as they're led to the van. It's the screwed up romance of it, like watching TV shows about hospitals when no one really wants to be in one. This is how you get a job in a whorehouse. I was a phone girl in a whorehouse on East 49th Street. The name Candy. I got the job right on Halloween night. I remember going for my interview to this anonymous, ugly East Side building and walking down a long corridor that stank of cleaning fluid and perfume. I went into a tiny office off a main living room, which was done in a very sort of Bloomingdale's furniture floor kind of decor. And sitting in the chair was a girl who was enormous. She had like 100 pounds on me. And her voice was like this. You'd think that they wanted this. But no, they wanted this. Like a little girl. She was the headphone girl. She was in charge of schedules and cleaning guys, and she hired me. I made $50 a shift plus $5 for each booking. A session, as it was called. Girl or girls in a room with a man for half hour or hour increments. Good money. Now, I was basically a pimp, and if the place had been busted, I would have been in the deepest kind of trouble because soliciting over phone lines is a federal offense. So sat in my scuzzy little office at a cheap prefab desk, beige phones and a wall phone, the private line. Grimy walls with unexpected smears of color from someone's lipsticky finger. The shift was around 8 hours, and about 5 to 6 girls worked each shift.
And we would hang out and gossip and try on lipsticks. The phone's ringing, ringing, me doing my phone rap.
Hi. Yes, we have a very beautiful redhead, an ex-cheerleader.
Pamela sprawled in the armchair doing the sort of bored rah-rah kind of thing.
Yes, garter belts are extra. You can talk about it with the girl. Yes, we have an athletic brunette and a very busty blonde. 38D. Got a pen?
The buzzer would ring and one of the girls would get up, everyone going, you get it, I got it last time. Pick up the intercom. Hi.
Hi. It's John. I called.
Oh, sure, John. Come on up. It's a wallet, girls. John enters and they escort him over to the conversation pit, asking him about baseball or was there a lot of traffic? Never mentioning money or sex. They would sit there for a few minutes, some of them like Robin, making no effort whatsoever, just swinging one crossed high-heeled foot. Finally, Guy goes, you. Girl shows him into a room and says, make yourself as comfortable as the day you were born, and I'll be right back. This meant be completely naked when I get back, because if he's naked, he can't arrest you. That would be entrapment. Sometimes guys would come and ask, how much is it to go down on me? And the girls would say, we only discuss the sports or the weather. And if they're really persistent, then the girls knew that the guys were cops and played really stupid until they left. So the girl who was picked comes back to the office, leaving him to undress and hopefully... In all the romanticizing of whoring that I've ever seen, this has never touched on. The sheer volume of so much intimacy, people's personal hygiene, their really distinct smell and taste, to have to shut yourself off to it. Okay. John is undressed in the room. Girl negotiates time and extras. Kissing is extra, butt stuff extra, etc. She signs out the room and pays me the house share, 60% cut. Now, there are 5 bedrooms. 2 down the hall, 1 upstairs, and 2 studio apartments down the outside hall. So 5 to 6 girls worked a shift. On a good night, they could all be busy. On a slow night, if the buzzer rang and nobody made a move toward the living room, I would get really pushy. I wanted that $5. I'm like, go ahead, go out. You look great. You're going to get picked. Go out. Go out. Go out. I mean, I wore dirty sweatpants and red compulsively, and from where I sat, they dressed up. They put on lipstick. Guys liked them. I envied them. Robin was my fave. She wore a white ruffled dress and high heels, and she had very round silicone breasts that we were all fascinated by. And she had the sexiest walk I've ever seen. She walked really slowly, and she sort of rolled. She had a tight, tough little Irish face, gruff voice, never smiled. And I worked to make her laugh more than I've ever done for any audition or any play. And when I got her, she'd give a bark, a, huh, and say, Candy, you're crazy. And smile, the sweet smile with little chiclet teeth and dimples. She wanted to be a dog groomer. She loved dogs. She had 2 big huskies. She was from a series of foster homes and factory jobs. And when she and a friend first ran away to New York, this young black guy picked them up. And he must have been very new at it, because he took them out, he bought them clothes, he got them high. And they said, all right, now you got to make money for me. And they said, sure. And he left them on a street corner, and they cut out, and they never saw him again. And then she got a real pimp, though, and she couldn't get away from him. And she told me how one night in their room at an SRO hotel, she waited until he was sleeping, and then barefoot, with her boots in her hand, crept down the stairs to the lobby. And he caught her there. And she said, well, he kept hitting me in the same spot, right here, showing me a scar by her eye. Well, he kept hitting me, had this ring on, and it was so much blood that finally some guy stopped him, and I thought I was going to go blind. She finally got away, and she met Jojo. Jojo was in the Merchant Marines. He had on a uniform when she met him, and he would leave her money when he went away, but she kept on hooking, and soon he stopped working and lived off her. It always worked like this. At first, these guys would work, but these weren't guys with big money jobs, and why go to work for a fraction of what she can make in a night? So a pimp is born. They all had a story. One young woman, Kathy, was 6 months pregnant and worked in tandem with her mother and her little sister. And her little sister, Debbie, told me how one night her mother in the car, to go find Kathy because we heard she was hooking. We saw in the street she looked like a clown. Her face was all white like a clown's, and she had two red spots here. And her mouth was all red like a clown. And my mother pulled her in a car, starts beating on her, going, "You're a hoa, you're a hoa." And she said, "Yeah, but look what I made." Kathy gave me a green suede belt for Christmas. There was Gloria, very tall, very thin, beaky nose, hair parted in the middle in two precise waves. You'd have thought she was a secretary or a sales clerk, except that she wore lavender cutout bell bottoms from Fredericks of Hollywood. She always sat in the armchair and she did needlepoint, you know, like puppy kitten kind of stuff. And she said, "Right," every three words. "How did I get started? Right?" Well, we used to swing, right? And Bobby said, "Let's try this, right? It'll be kinky, right? Well, you know, right?" I'd say stuff to the callers just to make the girls laugh. "Hi.
Hi. Do you have any girls there with fingernails?"
"No, sorry. They're all nail biters here."
"Hi."
"Hi. Hello. Hi. What do you look like?"
"I'm 5'3". I'm about 250 pounds and my hair is dirty." "Hi."
"I'm coming."
"Good for you. On the paper. On the paper."
Sometimes if I worked a double shift there, like 16 hours in a row, I'd have to sleep there all by myself. And I always woke up crying. It was a bad place. Made me sad. Made me old.
The pimp, Steve, was a 40-ish prepster with Brooks Brothers shirts and the flat, dead eyes of a coke fiend. Practically impotent, hated women, scared me. Screw him, I thought, and I started splitting his share with the girls. I got fired. And I thought, all right. Better get a job near the whorehouse. So, I buy Screw magazine, and I set up an appointment. I go to 48th and Lexington Avenue. It's a much seedier place. I remember walking down a long hallway with rooms off it, and looking in one, and seeing a girl lying on a bed, fully dressed, just staring at the ceiling. Woman shows me into a room and says, "Make yourself as comfortable. It's the day you were born. I'll be right back." So no, 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 the phone job. Door shuts. Right. Right. I could be a cop. Maybe I could leave on my underpants. So I stepped off my shoes. I rolled down my tights. And I stopped. I stood there, alone in a room in a whorehouse. I walked out, and I cried on the street. When I was a child, I was like Lear. I thought, I will do such things.
Nel mezzo del cammin di nostra vita, mi ritrovai in una selva oscura. In the middle of my road, I found myself in a dark wood. And like Dante, in order to find my way out, I first descended. Descended into a fetid, damp basement room on 33rd Street. An answering service, a legitimate business, a real job. I even had my Virgil, my guide, in the unlikely form of a 6-foot black transvestite named Faye. And Faye was really big. She had big face, big hands, long red fingernails, thick pancake makeup that left stripes on the insides of her shirts. She lived in Harlem with a man, in a huge apartment with like a stereo in every room and 10 TVs. She told me how she'd started this answering service with this young Jewish guy named Marty, and they took turns crashing on the sofa, keeping it going 24 hours a day. Unlikely duo, great friends. Enter me into this windowless room filled with lopsided, ratty office furniture, and just me and Faye. And we would hang out and watch this old black and white TV that only worked if you touched it. So we'd take turns balancing one toe on it until it got really annoying. We'd say, "Oh, screw it, shut it off." And I worshipped her. I worshipped her. Doctors, lawyers, bankers, brokers would call for their messages and she'd say, "What? I have to do what? No, child. All I have to do is stay black and die. Now, let me ask you something. How big is your Johnson?" "Oh, don't lie to Faye now." And she'd laugh and laugh, and they worshipped her. And they'd call up and tell their problems and say, "Faye,
friend on the phone. Will you curse at my friend, please?
Delivery guys would come. You know, bagel, coffee, light. And she'd say, you see her hands there? Pointing to me. Do you see how small her hands are? Do you know how big that would make your thing look? And I'd be like, Faye. And I was always miserable. I was always complaining. So fat. So poor. Everyone is having more fun than me. And she'd lean over the table and tap one long red fingernail. And she'd say, it ain't all about you, Chloe. It ain't that kind of party. About a year after I left the job, I called Faye. And I don't normally keep in touch with people from jobs because the relationships are real, but they're site-specific. But I would call Faye. Well, Faye had a stroke. She was all right, but her mouth's a little skewed. About 6 months later, I call again. Hey, Faye. Hey, Chloe. Faye had a second stroke. Maybe it was the hormones. And said that very ill in the hospital, I'd had a spiritual thing. Said that after a lifetime of never feeling happy or satisfied, I decided to just be what I was. A man. I'm Frank now, he said. And I'm very happy. You be happy, Chloe. Happy? Repeat after me. Oddio, ma quanto ho voluto essere un'attrice italiana famosa, ma proprio famosa, come Silvana Mangano o Anna Magnani. Oh, my God. How I wanted to be a famous Italian movie star. Really famous. Like Silvana Mangano or Anna Magnani. I began training for this transformation by studying and perfecting the art of cafe sitting in the Piazza Navona in Rome. Or as I like to think of it, the art of speculation.
Scusa, hai da accendere? Grazie. Non sono americana, sto visitando Roma. C'è un'amica che abita là, via dei banchi vecchi, bellissima, un appartamento bellissimo, su, con terrazza, tutto. Vorrei un Campari Sole, per piacere. Okay, we're set. The art of speculation is this. Man walks by, he sees you, he stops dead. This is not considered aberrant behavior in Italy. Why did he stop? Because you're there. Now, turn your head very slowly. Lower your glasses slightly. Very calm. This part isn't easy. I always want to giggle, and it's the kind of nervous where your butt muscles clench. Now you look at each other, and you speculate. Graphically. Without saying a word. Oh, cara, ti prendo, ti faccio morire. Well, I shouldn't, but I can't resist the tongue slide down the neck, the hard grip under the butt, the bending back. But at this point, you must smile slightly and look away.
Oh, I forgot. A newspaper's a really good idea. So you read your paper blindly, and he waits to see if you look up again, and you feel that flush in your throat, because if you do look up again, that's not speculating, that's copulating. All right, you're still reading your paper, and he's walked away muttering something like, ammazza se bellissima. Having perfected both phases of speculating and copulating, I decided I was ready. I was ready to be an Italian movie star. So I get a part in an Italian film about a bordello. I get there the first morning and they say, okay, girls, take off your clothes, put on your bathrobes, and go to makeup. Makeup? I'm psyched. I love makeup. This is what they did. This is not what I had in mind, guys. I wanted glamour. And I look like the offspring of a girl from Bensonhurst and a Klingon. Costume designer comes in, very Swiss, very gay, speaks Italian with a thick German accent. Okay, ragazzi, costumes. I call them Swiss Miss. So we line up at the door. First girl goes in. We all wait, sort of grinning weakly at each other, trying not to stare. Everybody looks really weird. Door opens. Girl comes out wearing a little sailor collar.
A little sailor hat. And nothing else. Door closes, opens. Girl comes out wearing a drum majorette jacket, a change purse, and nothing else. Door closes, opens. Girl comes out wearing a watch. I'm next. And I'm so scared, I feel seasick. And I go in and I grab Swiss Miss by both hands and I said, please, please, you gotta give me something to wear. Va bene, va bene, he says. This is what I get. Black sheer halter with a fringe. Silver belt with six colored chiffon scarves on each side. High heels, earrings, no change purse. Then we see our set. It's a cage with bars. I have to A, stand dead center, and sing. I fell in love with you the first time I looked into them, their eyes, and you have a certain little cute way. We spent the day surrounded by a pack. Trapped in through a machine billowing out smoke that smelled exactly like the incense at high mass. In a great big way for you. I stood next to this Roman girl, Anita, she of the change purse, who complained in a nasal, disgusted tone every time we had to do another take. Mamma mia, questa tortura cinese che non finisce mai. This Chinese torture will never end. It wasn't quite what I had imagined, but I did laugh so hard one day I knocked over the back wall of the set. The voice of the world says, hey, that's a great story. The voice of the world says, how old are you now? The voice of the world says, it's time to stop having stories, Claudia. It's time to have a life. And you brush this aside with a face and a wave and say, I'm fine, I'm fine, I'm fine. And inside you think they're right. I'm gonna end up a supermarket checkout clerk asking, Marty, is there a check on the Scott's issue? I still believe in adventure. I still believe what I read. I still believe in getting out of the house. A Rovin, since Rovin's been my Ruin. I'll go no more a roving with you, fair maid. Finally, a real adventure. A Hurricane Island outward bound survival course. I read a brochure that said, could you do it? And I thought, yes. And I got a Reader's Digest scholarship and a pair of sneakers for $1.99 from ABC Bargain Stores on Graham Avenue in Greenpoint, Brooklyn, and I went up to Maine to experience 28 days of physical, quaking terror. Standing on a dock at 5 a.m., all of us lined up, pale and goose pimply in our bathing suits, looking down into the steely, bone-cold water. There was no parallel in my life. Nothing about growing up in Brooklyn prepares you for the all-enveloping fear of being a speck on an endless wall of granite, with the emptiness all around you as you cling desperately to the rock face, muttering to yourself in the utterly unselfconscious way insane people do. I'm gonna move my foot now. I wanted to be like a hero in the wilderness. You know, the clean line of the jaw clenched stoically through moments of adversity. Bull. I did my course with my hands, my feet, my knees, my teeth, begging, crying, clogged with snot, dripping sweat, falling and scraping my hands, my knees, my face, my ass. I was the worst. I was fat. I was pale. I had no cool outdoor clothing. The wilderness having a fashion code as rigid as Soho. Our first sailing expedition, 30-foot open boat, 12 of us. After a while, a guy climbs over to the instructor. He goes, Paul, man, Paul, where do we go to the bathroom? Anywhere you like, said Paul, waving his arm over the ocean. Anywhere you like. Oh, my God. Climbing granite cliffs is a breeze compared to this. At least you get to keep your pants on. But to make duty in front of a dozen people? One young woman on my course, a Mexican millionaire named Maru Ruiz Francia, was perfectly willing to die of toxic shock until we worked out this method. All the girls would take their towels and go to the bow. Hold them up. Maru would come down, cross herself, lower her pants, place her bottom delicately on the gunwale, while I, in order to help her to relax, would have to stand there and sing, if ever I would leave you, it wouldn't be in springtime, seeing you in spring. And Paul in the stern would laugh and laugh. You see, Paul was the real thing. It wasn't just that I had a crush on Paul. It's that he was like my books. He was like my dreams. He's this huge French Canadian with a bushy beard and really twinkly eyes, and he laughed at everything. Not like a snide, commenting kind of laugh, but this embracing, joyful kind of laugh. Go ahead, he'd say. Go ahead. It'd make you happy. And when you finish the climb, the run, the task, he'd be waiting for you and say, okay, you happy now? He walked like a big cat, and he would sort of pick things off trees and eat them. And he could climb and sail and run and build a fire, and he was brave, and he'd had real adventures, and he could pick me up. On the edge of a climbing cliff, his helmet pushed to a rakish angle, his legs dangling over the edge as he'd look down and say, come on, Claudie, you can do it. Sing your way up. Sing for us. Me. Dying, my face jammed in some rock crevice, going, shut up, Paul. Screw you. And I'm going, oh, Claudie, I can hear you. On a late night sail, he'd stand against the mast, perfectly balanced, perfectly at ease, and we'd sing together. Vous avez nom que je voudrais pour ma maîtresse. Vous avez nom que les amours voudraient connaître. And my heart would feel like a balloon. One day after a group task, very outward bound, Paul said, okay, let's say you're going on a big expedition, okay? Choose your crew. Everybody was chosen except for me. And Paul said, okay, he said. Well, he said, if I were going on a big expedition, I would choose Claudia. Claudia? Me? Yeah, said Paul. Because in the wilderness, when things get tough, who runs the fastest or does things the best? That doesn't matter. It's a sense of humor. A sense of humor, and Claudia, she has that. There are very few moments in life where someone shows you a portrait of yourself, clean, clear, and totally unexpected. Never mind the sword pulling from the stone. This is the adventure. If for a moment you see someone differently, their portrait changes. It comes to life. The eyes follow you. They see you. I'm going to catch a train at Penn Station. I stopped to get a nice coffee. And I'm waiting behind this guy, and I notice him because he's kind of good looking. He's big, he's fair, he's got one of those Lands' End bags with that zipper pocket tennis racket thing. So I'm perusing the donuts, a little amused, because I love to watch grown-up men order treats, like some deep man's voice going, oh, no, the pink one with the sprinkles. All of a sudden, I look up as he throws the money down onto the counter, half of it like bouncing off, and the small Hispanic woman behind the counter, she flinches. Now, that does it for me. When I see that flinch, that blink of fear, that twist in the mouth that's an insult finding its mark, I look up at him and I say, why did you do that? He says, do you know how much a coffee and a donut costs here? So I said, she works here. She works here. She doesn't own the place. She works here for probably minimum wage under the lights of Penn Station, and you're catching a train with a tennis racket and you're throwing money at her? Well, it's really expensive, he says. And he goes to walk away, and I said, you overprivileged, fat-ass, white mother... And the muscle in his cheek is twitching, and he looks down at me and he says, I don't appreciate your attitude. I said, have you no shame? Have you no perspective? Well, he just walks away, and I'm left, as always, the adrenaline like pus in my stomach as people glance at me and look away. Woman behind the counter goes, so I go to walk away, and a table of, you know, Puerto Rican drug dealers and the white women who love them, they call me over, and they go, come here, come here, come here, come here. What? Come here, come here, come here. What? Good for you, they said. Good for you. Good for me. Okay. Let's make it a rule. You talk to the people who serve you the food the same way you talk to the people you eat the food with. You talk to the people you work for the same way you talk to the people that work for you. It's a one-size-fits-all proposition. Talk to people. Talk to people and they'll show you classical Indian dance, karate katas, eat
dressage, explain Hegel, Jung, Iris Murdoch, Prince, tell you about their hometown in Colombia, Sicily, Tasmania, Moscow, and make you laugh. I'm waitering in this ritzy restaurant in Chelsea, and I spy a busboy heading to the kitchen with an untouched steak. He's a Peruvian Pied Piper as four or five of us march into the kitchen, pushing, shoving, punching, tearing at the steak with our hands. The door swings open. We all freeze guiltily afraid it's the manager. It's another waiter who, without missing a beat, says, oh, look, dances with wolves. Sitting on rooftops, desktops, countertops, under counters, perched on milk crates, wine crates, paper cartons, back alleys, front steps, deserted cafeterias, spooky hallways, we're all the same. We're a motley crew of artsy-fartsy types and social misfits and single mothers and immigrants who work 6 days, double shift, send all the money home. We're people in recovery, people in denial, gay guys shocking the shit out of pizza guys from Queens, and vice versa. We all of us fit in because we none of us belong anywhere, and boy, what you can learn. Dirty words in every language. And the fact that nobody is just a typist, just a dishwasher, just a cook, just a porter, just a prostitute. That everyone has a story. Everyone here has at least one story that would stop your heart. Is this disjointed? Life doesn't have a topic sentence. There's nothing as cliched as a story of a road traveled, of lessons learned, of obstacles overcome. But you know why? That's because it's the only story. It's the big story. Simple as reading something in a book as a child, something that seems made like the phase of the moon, and then looking up one night at the sky and realizing that it's true, that you can see it for yourself. That's all I can say, really. These things are true. And I've seen them for myself. And this is job number 65, and now I dance.
We'll be preempting our regularly scheduled programs so that we may bring you tape-delayed coverage of the congressional hearings on the Waco controversy here on member-supported OPB next.
The presentation of American Playhouse is made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. By annual financial support from viewers like you. And by the National Endowment for the Arts.
Blend it in.
You'll be charmed. In the next Clive James postcard.
On OPB, Monday at 8.
Funding for local broadcast of American Playhouse has been provided by Boyd Coffee Company, a family-owned Oregon company providing espresso and gourmet coffees to restaurants and offices throughout the United States.
It's 1952, and Kevin Walker is a brash young FBI agent fresh out of law school.
This country is the greatest country on earth.
And he's about to get the assignment that will be his claim to fame.
I'm sending you boys to Chinatown.
The height of the communist witch hunt, and the Bureau was hungry for indictments.
Ron, you got a bad feeling about this.
When he convicts an innocent man to save his own career, his life is changed forever.
I curse you! I curse you, Miko the Chinaman!
No! He looks so alert, so full of hope. He's got the eyes of a warrior.
There's a fighter here, Dad.
Matt Dillon, Joan Chen, and Bruno Kirby star in David Henry Hwang's haunting tale of intrigue, revenge, mystery, and love.
How can you possibly lose an entire classified file?
Or a bag of state's evidence.
Is your real name Yuri, or Ho Chi Minh, or just plain Mora?
My name is Chen Jiangsong.
American Playhouse presents Golden Gate. The presentation of American Playhouse is made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, by annual financial support from viewers like you, and by the National Endowment for the Arts. Special funding for this motion picture was provided by the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, the Chubb Group of Insurance Companies, and the Rockefeller Foundation.
There was once a man who transformed himself into an angel. This is him in 1952. It's his 22nd birthday. He'd gotten it into his head that he was a killer in the looks department. And I guess that's all it takes to convince most people. He had one of the best jobs in the world. He was with the...
Don't tell me. FBI.
What gave me away?
Attitude, maybe?
It's my,
First day?
His name then was...
Kevin Walker.
You've been waiting for me.
Third floor.
On that day, he met his partner, Ron Pirelli. Ron was making a name for himself as the life of everyone else's party.
I grew up in New York City. Every day I open the Herald, I see pictures of G-Men. They're coming in and out of the store club, dames on each arm, every size and hair color you can imagine.
Wait a minute, how many different hair colors are there?
Two FBI men out on the town? We are gonna have a great time. See, we're fighting communism. We're protecting your right to wear those frilly little dresses with your little low-cut tops like that. Those beautiful knockers of yours practically falling out.
Hey, hey, hey.
What?
You can't tell a girl her knockers are falling out of her dress.
All right. Dumb, dumb. She might put them back in. Also, it's not classy, right? To draw attention to a jugs like that.
That's one way of putting it.
Okay, forget the jugs. Kevin, how can I forget the jugs when they're all around me? Why aren't they all swarming over here? But don't they know who we are?
Hey, hey, get a hold of yourself. Now you go over that one more time, okay?
Right. It's communism, see? We're fighting communism.
Do you want to dance?